I'm so grateful for the privilege of ministering here. This is this is my first time. Could someone do this for me? Yeah. I always forget when I'm. this is the second time I'm in Wales. I was here for a spring harvest in the 90s. And this is the next time, but this time I really struggled with what I should speak. I prayed and prayed and prayed, and somehow I felt I had resurrected an old message that I had done on Stephen, and somehow I felt that maybe this is going to help the people here. So that's what I decided to speak on Stephen, because I think the life of Stephen has a lot to say to people just like you who are trying to reach a nation that has in many ways rejected the gospel. Let's go through this passage verse by verse. The first thing that we hear that comes before actually the reading, which is in chapter 6 and verse 5. You know that Stephen was a person who was one of seven chosen to wait at tables. But regarding Stephen, there are two special things that are said. It says, and verse 5 of Acts 6, and what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Now, it is Stephen whom they describe like this. Everyone who was in this group needed to be filled with the Spirit. But these two characteristics are specially given concerning Stephen. So let's look at these two. First, we are told he was full of faith. Now, faith, of course, is a basic characteristic of Christianity and needed for anyone, but it is also presented in the listing of gifts in 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 9 as a gift. Some people have the gift of faith, and certainly it was needed for people like Stephen, who were bold pioneers taking the church in new directions. Stephen is going to blaze new trails for the gospel. And he's going to trust God and take the risks that trusting God involved. In the book of Acts, two people are described as full of faith. The first is Barnabas, or the second is Barnabas, in Acts chapter 11 and verse 24, when he went to Antioch and he saw that the grace of God, and was glad, and we are told he encouraged them to persevere in their faith. And then we are told, for he was a man full of the Spirit and of faith. A good man, full of the Spirit and of faith. Barnabas needed faith to see the possibilities of grace in this new church. And he's a person who took the risk of trusting grace to see people through. He did this with Saul, whom everybody was questioning and wondering, who is this person? Barnabas took the risk of taking him right into the inner circle. What if he was a spy? This was what he would have been waiting for, to get right into the inner circle. But Barnabas took that risk. He took the risk of believing in Mark, who finally, of course, blazed great trails for the gospel, wrote a gospel and went to Egypt and started the church, which is still thriving in that country. And so he needed faith to trust God. Stephen similarly needed faith to trust God to help in the trail that he was going to blaze. He needed it to follow through with the implications of the truth that he realized, the gospel included. And he took the risk of antagonizing the Jewish leaders. So he had faith in the initiative that God had given him. And he took the church in new directions. I think we need to identify people with the gift of faith and listen to them and follow their lead. I think through the years, the church has brought these pioneers, Hudson Taylor, George Mueller, people like that come to mind, but there are many others. I was leader of Youth for Christ for 35 years, working with an organization that is always innovating, trying new things and all of that. And I am not a person with a lot of faith like that. And I had to depend on others to take on these bold ventures. And I stood behind them and pushed them and gave them the sort of like the encouragement, the public face of approval, and helped them to pursue the dreams that God had given them. But the church and church history has been colored with pioneers who took great leaps forward for the church in obedience to a vision that God gave them. And we need to encourage them. I think of Hudson Taylor. 2 years after he landed in China, his girlfriend wrote to him, his fiance wrote to him and said, I'm sorry, I don't think I love you anymore. The church, the mission organization that was sending him, wrote back and said, I'm sorry, we don't have funds for you anymore. And then the British consul in the area that he was prohibited him from working in that area. The other missionaries shunned him because he seemed to be, going to these extremes of trying to identify with the Chinese people. And he wrote to his mother and said, my heart is sad, 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 and I don't know what to do. At that time, an older Scottish missionary took him under his wing and traveled with him. And one of his biographers says, Hudson Taylor was saved from himself by William Burns. William Burns cared for him, encouraged him, and he may have become one of these eccentric radicals who didn't really do much for the kingdom, but this man helped him. So I think when we find people like Stephen, they could be very uncomfortable. We may be very uncomfortable with them. The church may be uncomfortable with them. But if we see that spark of faith, of trusting, of wanting to go forward, I think we need to do all we can to help them, to encourage them. Now we come to verse 5. Verse 5 says he was not only a man full of the faith, but of the Holy Spirit. And verse 8 says he was full of power. Now, in verse 3, all needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But here, he's especially mentioned. In the book of Acts, the fullness of the Holy Spirit is used in two ways. One is to describe a person. So Stephen and Barnabas are described as people filled with the Spirit. It seems as if when you look at them, you know that that God is in them, that they are filled with God. Their actions, their nature shows who God is. The other way in which this is used is for sort of an episodic fullness, for some particular challenge where you are given the privilege of doing something for God and God fills you, anoints you. We used to call it unction those days. Anoints you for the task of doing this. So both of these ways of using the fullness of the Spirit is used for Stephen. Later we are told he was filled with the Spirit as he was facing death. So he must have stood out as being a person whose life and ministry exhibited spiritual power. And then, of course, we are told that with that, in verse 8, he was full of power and was doing great signs and wonders among the people. So in verse 10, so the people could not withstand the wisdom or the spirit by which he was speaking. Paul tells all believers that they need to be filled with the Spirit, which suggests that all believers are not filled with the Spirit. This is something that we have to pray and ask God. Our constant prayer is, oh God, may I be full of you. May I be full of you. Verse 8 tells us something else about him. We are told, and Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great signs and wonders among the people. The power, of course, again, you see where faith comes in. People who do signs and wonders believe that God is going to do something amazing, and they trust God, and they launch out into this, into acts of faith that result in signs and wonders for the kingdom. And so that faith expressed itself in believing God to do special things. And also with that power, power exhibited through his ministry, we are told he was full of grace. Seeing it next to power, commentators think that power possibly was the external manifestation of God's work in his life. Grace was the internal expression, the internal manifestation of God's work in his life. Grace was shown in his character. He was a gracious person. You know, he was a fearless debater. He was not timid, but he was also a gracious debater. Some people of great faith exercise great power, and they debate, and they are pioneers, blazing new trails for the gospel. They are very tough and determined, so determined and fearless, even in the face of death. But some of them are not very gracious. But not Stephen. He was a radical, but he was not a rough, bitter pioneer. He was a gracious radical. I tell parents who are involved in ministry, be passionate and kind. Passionate for the mission that God has given you. Don't ever lose that passion. But also kind. Serving your spouse and children as their servant and doing all you can to be an agent of grace in their life. Passionate and kind, both are important. Here you are in the midst of a huge project for the kingdom. You're very busy, you're stressed out, rushing, tense. And you come home and you find that your wife is in a bad mood. And you say, oh no, not today. I have so much to do. And you can ignore the problem, or you can scold her for being a hindrance to your work. Or you can act with grace. What's the problem? And usually you ask a question like that, 2-hour conversation. What to do? Grace gives us the strength to persevere, to be passionate, and to be kind. You see this in Stephen's life. Then we come to verses 9 and 10. Verse 9 says, some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, and of the Cyrenians, and of the Alexandrians, and those from Cilicia and Asia, rose up and disputed with Stephen. They were from the synagogue of the freedmen, which probably means they were former slaves. And they were from Cyrene and Alexandria, which is in Upper Africa, and Cilicia and Asia, which is in Asia Minor, that is modern Turkey. These are diaspora Jews, probably Greek-speaking, Hellenists. Was Stephen a member of this church? We don't know. Was Saul a member? Probably not, because he calls himself a Hebrew of Hebrews, which means he must have gone to a Hebrew-speaking church. But verse 10 tells us that they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. This is inspired wisdom. He was powerfully applying scripture to the lives of the hearers. We call this contextualization. He was presenting the gospel in ways which enable hearers to fully understand and apply to their lives. That's what contextualization is. People will understand, they apply, and they realize they have to make a decision as to how to respond. His talk was all from their own history. They understood what he was implying. In fact, they understood it so well that they ended up killing him. So we are called to adapt to the culture. The unchanging message doesn't change, but the way we present it is done in a way that is appropriate to the culture, so that the people will understand the gospel and that unnecessary blocks would be removed. But the gospel call involves repentance, and some don't like that, so some are going to reject it. So that is our great challenge, to contextualize the message. I was once preaching to an audience of young people an evangelistic message. I preached on John 3:16, and I heard that there was a Buddhist in the audience. So when the meeting was over, I went up to him and I talked to him, and I said, in the midst of the conversation, I asked him, what do you think about what I said? He said, oh, it was very good. I fully agree with what you said. In fact, our religion says the same thing as you said. Now, I thought I had given a message that was so different to Buddhism. But he had taken my words and he had attributed to it Buddhist meanings. And he ended up from my evangelistic message with a Buddhist message. I had not contextualized. I had not been able to penetrate the heart and the mind of this person with the radical truth of the gospel. So we need to battle to contextualize. This is something that is our calling. And Stephen, of course, became a model of the later apologists who dominated Christian history during the first three centuries. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says, we destroy arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. This should be one of the verses that drives us in our work. How can we penetrate these people's hearts and minds so that they not only understand, but they are challenged by what we say, and challenged to respond to the gospel. But this was not a dry intellectualism. The spirit was there. So we are told they couldn't withstand the spirit with which he spoke. Here is knowledge on fire. Luke 24 and verse 32. Did not our hearts burn within us when he talked to us on the road and opened to us the scripture? The spirit was at work through his preaching. What we see here is a balanced Christian worker in the biblical understanding of balance. The world may look at biblically balanced people and say that they are crazy because we go to extremes in our obedience to Christ. But you see this balance. He was a scholar and he was a saint. He was powerful and he was gracious. And he was an apologist who was spirit-filled. The complete armor of an evangelist. How then do we acquire such inspired wisdom? Let me suggest a few ways, six ways in which we do this. First, I think we need to know the scriptures. I remember in 1978, the first time I went for an international conference, and the hero of the conference was John Stott. So we had a question time with John Stott. And the word contextualization was just beginning to get known. And John Stott, somebody asked John Stott, how do you contextualize? What is necessary for contextualization? And I never forget John Stott's response. He said, the first thing a contextualizer needs is to know the scriptures. We need to know the scriptures. Today, because that's the stuff out of which our gospel presentation comes. There's a dangerous trend from a lack of trust in the power of the word. You know, we have heard irrelevant Bible exposition. I don't know how Bible exposition could be irrelevant, but sometimes people get bored with the exposition of scripture. And having heard that, we say, no, I'm not exegeting scripture, I'm exegeting culture, you know. And of course we have to exegete culture. But we exegete culture out of a background of our belief that God has spoken the word that is the answer to the needs of the human race. I was at a consultation in Sri Lanka on how to evangelize the country, what our mission should be in our country, about 4 or 5 weeks ago. And one of the things that was said is, we can't be getting our strategy from Acts. We have to be looking at the culture and getting our strategy from there. For a person who has studied Acts all his life, I was more than a little upset. I think we need to know the scriptures. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing the division of the soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. So the scriptures speak to us. They keep us in line. You know, when you go into the world, there are so many things that can detract. And the scriptures give us that our bearings. We can always come back to the scriptures. We get all these wonderful ideas. And then we ask, does this square with what the scriptures say? Is the scriptures implying this? And that helps us to take our next step forward. So we must know the scriptures. Then we need to know the people to whom we minister. We study. You know, John Stott used to use the famous phrase, double listening. We listen to the Bible and we listen to the world. And there are different ways in which we do this. One is indispensable way is being with people. You know, we can't run away from that. And those of us who are in ministry have to work really, really, really hard to not only be with Christian leaders and other mature Christians. We have to work proactively, go after the people who need to hear the message most. Being with people. Then observation. We are looking all the time, looking. In Sri Lanka, it's the poor who travel by bus, but I work with the poor. So every month, I take one or two rides in a bus as part of my education. I want to see what happens in the bus. You know, how people behave, how people get in, how people get out. That's part of our call to know the world. John Wesley was walking along the street with one of his young preachers whose name was Sammy. And they came across two women who were fighting. They were having a quarrel, and it was quite an interesting quarrel, so a lot of people were watching. The young preacher Sammy, wanted to go away from this place. And John Wesley told him, stay, Sammy, stay and learn to preach. You know, when we look at people, we learn how to preach. Then we read. We read about what is happening. We watch. We watch the things that people watch. And this is one of the major challenges that we have today, to find time to watch what people watch, to read what people read, to know what is happening in the world. And let me say that this is an area that is fraught with problems. On the one hand, we can be so this material is presented in such an attractive way that it is able to penetrate our hearts much quicker than the theology that we read. And so it could have a greater influence on us than the word and the theology. And we could end up syncretistic. On the other hand, there is a lure in finding out about the impurity of the world. You know, those of us who are ministering are fighting sin. We are fighting unholiness. I found this thing about the Me Too movement, you know, all these people, and now it has hit the church. And I suddenly realized that I am getting unhealthily interested in this Me Too thing, you know, to find unnecessary pleasure from reading about the sins of people. So when you go into the world, we have to be careful. We have to open ourselves to the world, but have ways by which we can ensure that the world doesn't make us impure. John Stott, writing long ago in a different era about going for movies, said that he would go for movies with friends, so that together they observe this. Today, life has got so privatized that a lot of our watching and our reading is alone. And so I think we need to be very careful. I have a group of friends to whom I report on my reading, my watching, so that I don't, unconsciously lose myself while trying to find out about the world. So I think all contextualization takes place in community. Because when you contextualize, we all can go to extremes, and the community helps bring us into some sort of equilibrium or to a biblical balance. As someone said, we need prophets and teachers in the church. The prophets blaze new trails. The teachers make sure that those trails are responsible, are biblical. So we need to read, to open ourselves to the world. And then personal work. How important personal work is for us to understand what is happening. Where we work with people, and through working, we find out the issues that people are facing. I'll talk about that a little later. So that's the second. We need to know the people to whom we minister. Thirdly, we use our knowledge of the scripture and of people to apply this truth penetratively to our audience. So there is exegesis of the Bible, there is exegesis of scripture, and then there is application. We take this knowledge and we apply that. So this is where very often personal work is so helpful. When we do personal work, anyone doing personal work, if you're anything like me, would know that sometimes our failures are more than our successes. It's nice for us to come to these places and preach like big shots, but when you're with your own people, trying to battle for the souls of people, we face so much failure. And I have learned more from my failures than from my successes. Because we ask, what went wrong? Why didn't I understand him? Why didn't he understand me? What is the problem? Why is sin so powerful in his life? And so we theologize. Our failures force us to theologize and ask, what is the answer to the problem? And of course, successors encourage us to follow these paths because they may be the paths that God has called us to go. So we work with people and then we think. We think and think and think. Integration of knowledge takes place when we stop to think. How can I do this? How can I get through to them? My thinking time is when I walk. Now I don't present this as a model to anyone, but I don't take, my phone with earphones because I want to use my walking time just to think. And we think and think and think and ask, how can we reach this? How can we get to our people? How can we break through? How can we open? How will they open the door to the gospel? Here is this treasure that we have, and they don't know about this treasure. How can I break through? So we think, and think. And then we look for a medium to present this message in a way that they will hear. Our people, of course, are story people. And I think everybody is story. The Bible is full of stories. The value of stories is that sometimes people are not necessarily impressed by our argument for the truth. But sometimes when they see the truth demonstrated, they instinctually accept, this is true. And from the heart, it goes to the mind. Maybe this is one of the challenges that postmodernism has given to us. Not only do we always go from truth to faith to feelings, sometimes feelings help trigger faith, which in turn leads to fruit, to the truth. Always the truth is primary. Always the scriptures are primary, but the way in which people perceive truth can differ from person to person. And for our culture, stories is one of those important ways. So we work with people, we think, and we use the most appropriate way to communicate this message. Then fourthly, we ensure that there are no hindrances to the infilling of the Spirit. I've so far talked about penetrative insight, the truth that we give. Now let's talk about how we can be filled not only with truth, but with wisdom, but with the Spirit. Jay Kessler was a leader of Youth for Christ in America, and he was also a pastor of a church. And he used to say that very often on a Sunday, he would park the car in the parking lot, and before he gets out, he's pleading with his wife to forgive him for something he has done. He knew that he cannot go and speak after he has hurt his wife. We ask ourselves, we confess every known sin, and ask God, please, 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 if there is anything that I don't know, please tell me so that I can be clear. There will be no hindrance to the Spirit from working in our lives. I think that sense of the immediacy, that we have cleared everything so that God can fill us. It's an old truth, but a truth that we must not forget. We have to have our lives in order. And then, fifthly, through prayer, we make sure that we are in tune with the mind of the Spirit. W.E. Sangster, Methodism's best-known preacher in Britain. You can suspect what denomination I have come from, right? He has written a book called Power in Preaching, where he talks about the steps to preaching. And he talks about the word unction, which we don't use nowadays very much, he says, I suppose we use the word anointing. And he describes unction how unction comes by saying that we are like a boat in a lake or a sea, a sailboat, and we have to turn our sails so that we can catch the wind of the Spirit. And then we catch this wind and we are directed along. The Spirit leads us along as we go through our work. So we tune ourselves. That's another figure that we can use. Tuning ourselves so that we are in touch and we are moving in the same direction as God. There's an Afro-American preacher who was asked how he prepares his messages. And he said, three steps. I read myself full. Second, I think myself clear. Third, I pray myself hot. Read yourself full, think yourself clear, pray yourself hot. I remember I was speaking at a conference, Amsterdam 2000 conference for evangelists. I don't know how many evangelists there were, but I think there were about 10,000 there. And I was speaking in the morning. I got up early morning to pray. And I was just kept telling God, Lord, please fill me, fill me, fill me. After some time, I thought maybe God is also getting tired with the same prayer being repeated over and over again. And then I thought, well, why don't I take my prayer list? And I just kept going from name to name in the prayer list. But what I was doing, I realized later, was I was getting myself attuned to God. When we minister with God, we have to be in tune with God. And there are few ways of doing this as best as praying and spending time in the Word. One of the, maybe I'll talk about that during the interview, I don't know. But one of the things that we need to be doing is to make sure that we are in step, as J.I. Packer called his book on the Holy Spirit, keep step with the Spirit. We just keep step with Him and go the way He wishes us to go. So we attune ourselves to God. And then we pray for infilling. We pray to God to fill us, to serve Him. What we are talking about is an attitude of helpless dependence which opens us so that the Spirit can fill us. It's an attitude of dependence. Charles Spurgeon, we are told, actually I found this out from a person who's a good friend of the European Leadership Summit Forum, MacDonald, the one who heads up Christian Focus. He told me that when Charles Spurgeon used to go to preach, he would... with every step, he would say, I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Spirit. It was a conscious recognition that it was not him who was the key to the message, but he had to be open so that the Spirit comes. So when we are ministering, counseling, witnessing, talking to people, preaching, teaching, we are always praying. With our mouths we may be talking. In our hearts we are saying, Lord, please help, please help, please help. So that God can fill us through our dependence. Okay, then let's look at the opposition that Stephen faced in his ministry. Verse 11. Then they secretly instigated men who said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. So this is not the first time a brilliant person has been confronted by the laws of the land or the laws of the church in order to silence them. They tried to debate him. They found they couldn't debate him and win. So they silenced him through the law. I think we need to be very careful when brilliant people come. sometimes we use tradition to stifle them. And because their creativity, we can't handle the new paths they are taking us along. We use tradition, the laws, the rule book, the laws of the land, of the church, to try and stifle them. Verse 12. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and they came upon him and seized him and brought him before the council, the Sanhedrin. Then the false witnesses say that he never, this is verse 13, never ceases, this man never ceases to speak words against this holy place and the law. So that's their accusation. He's speaking against the holy place, the place of God, and the place of the law, Moses' law. So he's speaking, blaspheming against God and Moses. And then verse 14, we have heard him say that this Jesus will destroy, of Nazareth, will destroy this place and change the customs that Moses delivered to us. When Judea became a Roman province in AD 6, capital punishment was only the Roman governor had permission to rule capital punishment, except for offenses in word and deed against the temple. For those, people could be executed. They could pronounce and execute the death sentence. So when they tried Christ, they failed. So they had to send him to Pilate. With Stephen, they succeeded. So we come to verse 15. And gazing at him, all who sat in the council saw that his face was like the face of an angel. Even today, you know, when some people speak, people say there's a glow on his face. It's like as if God is reflected through him. So through communion with God, through speaking his truth, our God is a speaking God, something of God's glory is reflected in his ministry. Isn't it interesting that the same thing was said about Moses in Exodus 34, 29 and following, and then in 2 Corinthians 3, verses 12 to 18, we are told that Moses also, his face was shining. So here is a person reflecting God and shining like Moses, and he's accused of blasphemy against God and Moses. How people who think they are true to God's word can get it so wrong. They are thinking they are fighting for Moses and for God, but they are fighting the best representatives of Moses and God. You know, people can get stuck on new ways that have been discovered by bold trailblazers. And soon that becomes the normal way. The revolutionary way becomes the normal way in the next generation. And then it could be made into an oppressive tradition that opposes anything new. So the children of revolutionaries become reactionaries who stop and stifle revolutionaries. Then we come to Stephen's speech. It's a long speech. We are not going to follow the whole thing. But verse 1 of chapter 7 says, and the high priest said, are these things so? And Stephen responds. The longest speech in the book of Acts, so obviously extremely important for Luke to give so much space to this book. If you look at this speech, you find three themes crisscrossing, coming over and over again, here and there, just coming one after the other. The first is that the activity of God is not confined to the geographical land of Israel. Several times he says how God acted outside, did wonderful things outside the geographical land of Israel. The second truth that keeps coming is that worship acceptable to God is not confined to the Jerusalem temple. God can be worshipped outside Jerusalem also. And thirdly, the Jews have constantly rejected God's representatives. Three things that he brought in typical Eastern style, round and round, bringing it in, and then going to the other theme, bringing it in, over and over again, he brought this. And then he ends up in verses 51 to 53 with a strong word to these people. He says, "You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You have received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it." How close to the method of Jesus. You know, later we find that priests accepted the gospel. We are told that even priests were among those who accepted. But this was consistent with the practice of Jesus. He reserved his harshest criticism to religious leaders and not to overt sinners, whom he invited to discipleship. But to the leaders who professed to be representatives of God, he criticized. This is biblical contextualization. Faithful to the scriptures, speaking in the language that was understood by the audience, using material they already knew, he didn't tone down the message. And by leaving the unpleasant things or things that they didn't agree with. We call this critical contextualization. That's a word that was made popular by the famous Christian anthropologist Paul Hebert. Contextualize, but do so critically. I think this is a major challenge in our pluralistic environment today, where tolerance has been elevated and redefined to preclude things like conversion. Tolerance precludes conversion. Stephen Neal, the great Anglican bishop who served in India for many years, speaks of the awful and necessary intolerance of truth. The awful and necessary intolerance of truth. We don't court opposition by unwise activity. We are very careful about the way we present our message and the way we behave. But we also don't tone down the reality of our belief. With irreligious people, I don't think the method of Stephen of scolding them is going to work. I think there is another approach that we have to adopt. I was just so encouraged a few days ago to read about some legislation they were bringing up in California. Anti-conversion legislation. We, of course, think of anti-conversion when it comes to religion. But here it was sexual orientation. And one of the leaders of the gay rights movement was going to present this in the California representatives, Assembly of Representatives. And but it so happened that this man also had a very good friend who was a Christian. Was a Christian leader, actually the former president of the National Association of Evangelicals. And they were good friends. And the day before the thing was presented in their parliament, this friend said why this anti-conversion legislation is so dangerous. And it is a violation of human rights. The same day, the person who was pushing this legislation withdrew because he was convinced by his friend who was speaking against anti-conversion. So I think we have to really ask ourselves, how can we engage our culture? I think today, apologetics is being frowned upon as being intolerance. There's a book that came out recently called An Apology for Apologetics. Apologetics on behalf of apologetics. You know, it's so interesting. Earlier, our big battle was to teach, to present the truth of the gospel. Now our big battle is to present the validity of truth itself. So God is calling us to challenge our people. And may we be the type of people who will rigorously give ourselves to challenging our people with the message of the gospel. And as we do so rigorously, may we also guard our lives so that we are pure and we are filled with God's Spirit. Let's pray. Raise up such people, O God, in Wales. People who love you so much. People who love the people so much that they are willing to apply themselves, to guard themselves, to open themselves so that they could be used as your agents in this nation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.